Hello, you're watching Bones and Stones, and what I have here for you today is this parrotfish, which has been flown in from the Caribbean, according to the fishmonger, because it's a Jamaican delicacy. Now, you might be wondering, why is it called a parrotfish? And the answer is because of these beak-like teeth at the front of the fish here, although I should say it isn't actually a beak. Now, parrotfish are very difficult to identify because the colour pattern varies even within members of a single species, but I have used the key to identify this one as a striped parrotfish. I'll leave the key in the video description below. Parrotfish are very important to the ecosystem because they graze on the algae covering a coral reef, therefore keeping it clean. They'll actually eat the coral reef itself, that is the calcium carbonate exoskeleton that the coral polyps live in. And that's because algae doesn't just live on top, but it actually lives within the coral reef. And because of that, they actually digest this mineral and produce sand. In fact, it's estimated that 70% of the white sand of the Caribbean beaches and the Hawaiian beaches is actually just parrotfish poo. So in this video, I'm going to dissect this parrotfish and hopefully show you the amazing anatomy that allows them to create the lovely white sandy beaches that you enjoy on holiday. So without further ado, let's get started.
And as we always do with fish, we'll start from the anus here. There we are, so we can now see the adipose tissue surrounding the gut.
So the first thing that jumps out at us is this gas-filled bag here, which is the swim bladder used for regulating the fish's buoyancy. And embryologically speaking, it's actually an outpouching from the esophagus, and in some adult fish they still maintain this connection. It's called the ductus pneumaticus, and I believe the parrotfish is one such species, although I couldn't find this ductus because it was really small. So this large creamy structure is a testis because this fish is male. And the testis usually starts life at the back of the fish, adhered to the swim bladder, and enlarges towards the front of the fish as the fish sexually matures. So this fish is very sexually mature. So let's do a bit of blunt dissection here with the dissecting scissors, and then tidy away at the front. Then we just need to tease away at the tissue here. I think we're ready. So let's have a look at this. This is the testis, and if we fold this back, you can just about see that there's another testis on the other side, and in between we have the bowels. So that's the stomach there, that muscular bag. And then here is the other testis. And you can see that the two testes actually fuse at the front, which is unusual, but it's probably just a bit of ligament. The liver is probably in here somewhere as well, but we can't really get a view of it. Maybe we'll see it later. This green bag here is the gallbladder, of course, which stores the bile and secretes it into the bowels via this common bile duct, which you can see here. So that is a crucial part of the digestive system. Now, this almost black structure is the spleen, and that stores red blood cells and is also part of the lymphatic system. And then we have the swim bladder here again. Now let's try and get behind the swim bladder. Oh, there's a blood vessel that's supplying the swim bladder. Now if we carefully peel it away, we can see some other dark structures behind the swim bladder, and those are the kidneys of the fish. If you look behind the kidneys, there's also some yellow globular things, and that's probably just fat, although it might well be a testicular duct. You can't quite see here. It's very difficult to tell. So let's do a bit more dissecting and try and discern some finer structures here. I think we found the stomach. Yeah, that is indeed the stomach, this muscular bag here. That is the stomach. Now let's take the whole thing out and get a better view. There we are. So the first organ that you can see is the testis, which takes up most of the body cavity. And you might be wondering how I knew this fish was male before, and the answer is the colour pattern of the fish. You can divide parrotfish into different phases based on the growth, and at the beginning of their life cycle they start off as female, and then as they grow bigger their colour changes and they become male, hence how I knew this fish was male. That is the spleen there, just under the bowels. And then if we look back here, there's the gallbladder again, and you can see now that the testes are no longer fused at the front, so it probably just was a bit of a ligament which have teased away now. So let's try and get a better view of that bile duct. So we just need to gently stretch the tissues. And you can really get a good view of that bile duct now. Bile has a great many purposes, but the main ones are to emulsify the fat to make it easier to digest, because of a larger surface area, and the other one is to alkalize the digestive contents for the enzymes to work most efficiently. Now you can see the stomach here as I've stretched it out. There's little outpouchings. Those are pyloric seeker, and they basically increase the surface area for digestion. So I wonder what happened to that liver. Let's see if we can find it. If we have a look in here, I can't actually see the liver anywhere. I think it probably was buried in that massive tissue at the front of the testes. I wonder if we can see the heart. Yeah, you can just about see it back there. And it's in front of the gill, so it must be the heart. Although it could be confused with the liver. It's almost a similar colour. It's very big. I wonder if it is the liver. No, it's too far forward. It must be the heart. See if I can get it out. Oh no, I've destroyed it. Well, we'll never know. Anyway, let's go back to discussing the gastrointestinal system, because we didn't finish. We didn't answer the question of how the parrotfish actually turns the hard rocky coral into something that can even pass through the gut in the first place. And the answer lies in this bony protrusion here. But before we get onto that, we need to go to where the food enters the fish, the mouth. Now you can actually classify different species of parrotfish by how much destruction they do to the coral when they're feeding on it, and that ranges from excavating, to scraping, to grazing. Grazing obviously does the least damage, and this species of parrotfish is actually more of a grazer than an excavator, but it still has very tough teeth, some of the toughest teeth in the animal kingdom. And the morphology of the teeth actually let you identify the genus of the fish. So let's go back to this. This is actually the pharyngeal jaw. Yes, that's pretty much a second jaw in the throat of the parrotfish, which crushes and grinds the coral and mixes it with mucus into a fine slurry. This bit that I'm pulling out here is the lower pharyngeal jaw, and you can see the lower pharyngeal teeth, which are used to crush and scrape at the coral. Now let's pull out the upper pharyngeal jaw, which comes in two halves. That's the first half. And that's the second half. Let's look at them a bit more closely. You can see how sharp these pharyngeal teeth are. Remember, this is a jaw that's in the throat of the fish. Let's have a look at the other one. It looks pretty much the same. As you can see. But it's the lower pharyngeal teeth that I want to show you, because they are the strangest. They don't really look like teeth. Now, I put the lower pharyngeal teeth under the microscope after it finished cleaning up. So this is the microscope footage of the lower pharyngeal teeth, and you can see how beautiful and well-formed they are under the microscope. They don't look too sharp, but that's because they're not for cutting, they're for grinding. And if I zoom in further here at the back, you can see that as the teeth at the front here get worn down by grinding on the coral, they get flattened like this and migrate backwards. And then just as in a shark's jaw, you get new pharyngeal teeth springing up below these sharp ones here, and you can't see it because it would be on the underside within the jaw. You can actually see the parrotfish's last meal, because this green gunk here is a mix of dead algae, hence the green colour, some coral parasites, and then the fine sandy material in between is of course the ground up coral. So I think that is very interesting. Now, since I had my microscope out already, I couldn't resist putting something else under it. So what I chose was this scale of the parrotfish, and that's because I haven't actually talked much about scales in my other fish dissection videos. You can see that this scale is divided into two segments on the left and the right, and if we zoom in, we can see the difference. So the first thing you'll see are these rings in the scale, and these are actually growth rings, and it's possible to date a fish's age just by counting these rings. I'm not going to do that here though, because as you can see there's many of them, and it's unfortunately not as simple as one ring equals 1 month or even 1 year. Now if we look at the other segment of this scale, you can see all of these black dots here, and I'm not quite sure what they are, but I'd guess that this is pigments, which contributes to the colour of the fish, and the same goes for the actual pattern itself. So I thought that was interesting too. Now let's get back to the dissection.
Let's do my favourite bit, which is the eye. Yeah. So we can see this is the optic nerve. You've got the extraocular muscles surrounding it, and then you've got this lovely red eye. Interestingly, even the sclera has some blue pigmentation. Wasn't expecting that. So there is the eye. Now normally I dissect these, but I think I'm going to try and preserve this because I've dissected fish eyeballs before and they're all roughly the same. Got an infraorbital nerve there. Really see much else.
So that's everything that I wanted to show you. If you liked this video, I've done more dissections, and feel free to comment and subscribe.